So today what are we going to have? We are going to have case group presentation. Each group will present a case. The questions have been asked for each group, right? They will focus their presentation on the questions, okay, of niche. And it will carry 5 marks. You have 10 minutes to speak. So watch the clock. If you have a time overrun, you will lose marks, okay? After we finish the presentations, there will be questions, all right? And we will give 5 minutes time for the question. So that will be 15 minutes per group into how many groups? 6 groups. So that means how many minutes? 1.5 hours. And half an hour, we will have general discussion to bring out the learning points from this case. Okay? Case is on leadership. Okay, have you noted the time? 3:40. Your time starts now.
By now, I feel that most of us want to become a leader and not a manager. So the question of which we are trying to answer today is, what a leader, how is a leader different from a status quo-oriented manager with reference to the DVC? Now,
speak into it and don't fiddle with the switch, please. Into it, like a crooner.
Leadership copes with change. He develops a vision and aligns the people towards his vision and communicate the vision. In scenario of DVC, we have identified the incidences, the selection and then reflection. Selection of the incidences and reflection of the leadership qualities. The first incident was of that of strike. There was a strike which demanded a 12% bonus instead of 8.5% bonus. Showed some exceptional leadership qualities, which some of them which were highlighted how he tackled the strike were risk-taking abilities. Initially, there was no person, no head of the DVC previous who could challenge the union, but he did. It shows his exceptional risk-taking abilities. Another one is, he inspired trust among people. He was able to break the union unity, in the sense that he was able to influence the engineers and other union members. There were many unions, so he was able to inspire trust in him, and he said that I will be, he backed them so that they could come out of the inhibitions which were because of the politically related unions. The second incident was the beautification of the walls. Why? Because he thought that if the ambience is not good, people are not willing to work. His leadership qualities, challenging the status quo. Why? Because it has been there for many years. He changed that. In fact, he tore the very first poster himself. It showed his initiative taking abilities also. Then he was a very astute problem solver. Astute why? He brought in vagrants from outside to tow those posters, so that in case of a brawl, people are able to fight it out. Then the way he tackled that situation, after that he beautified the walls so that the ambience is good. He knew that this is one prime criteria why people he thought on a psychological point of view also. He thought that if the walls are beautiful, if the ambience is good, atmosphere is good, people are more willing to work. There are many other incidents like the school activity, the grievance balance, which will be taken care of by Gaurav.
Very happy to be within rules when there are no problems. Day to day jobs defined, and he operates within those rules and he doesn't risk to go beyond. In case of Mr. Luthar, what all the incidences highlight that he was very strict on rules, but
also he went beyond the rules
to justify
the needs of the people. Now, one of the incidences is, for example, that of the school, where he showed his ability to influence people. More importantly, he showed the empathy, how he recognized the real problem of the student. And the second incident was the grievance panel. Here it showed that he was very truly people oriented, and primarily he targeted people rather than the system or the structure. Basically, it was his whole aim was directed for improvement of the personnel. However, given that the means adopted by people, as long as they were within limits, only then he entertained the employees, which means that he was a fine blend of a strict disciplinarian and highly people oriented too. And what we could understand is he had an inclination to make DVC a people first culture. He wanted DVC people to imbibe that sense of pride while working as an employee of DVC, for example, while taking a ticket at the station, when the ticket collector entertained the personnel even after everything was over, and when he introduced himself as a DVC employee. The later part will be taken up by us.
One of the major qualities, one of the major leadership qualities which Mr. Luther exhibited during his tenure at DVC was the setting up of a very strong accountability system. Previously, people were not accountable to anybody else. Like the grievance redressal system, which brought in, helped quite a lot in the revival of DVC. In this, the major initiative of Mr. Luther was he made people accountable. And he gave a time frame of 90 days, saying that, look, if anybody has a problem, you directly write in to me. 90 days is the time. If that doesn't happen, then I am personally accountable. He thought that if people have grievances against their co-workers or the system, then it is the duty of the people to sort them out, and vice versa. This was one of the major initiative he had taken. And he also instilled respect among the workers, respect among workers and chief engineers, respect among skilled workers, unskilled workers. This was one of the major initiatives he had taken, and people realized their importance relative to each other, which brought in a very good work culture, and thus led to success of DVC. Then finally, the other general changes which Mr. Luther brought in would be taken up by Taneja.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
This since we have already talked about the selections and reflections of the DVC story, where various incidents were lined up, and it shows the qualities which was reflected by a leader. Now there are some general incidents not pertaining directly to the questions, but which shows the qualities of a leader in vis-a-vis status quo oriented manager. Like the leaders bring the change, cultural change, which leaders deal with the change, complexity of the change. This Mr. Luther, who brought up the various welfare schemes, which marked the improvement, like the teamwork, the people focus, all this were the cultural change. Other things which Mr. Luther acted, which shows his leadership qualities, is the qualities of walking the talk, in which whatever he persuaded people to do, he was also acting on that, and he was more focused towards the people rather than the system and the structure. He feels that people are most important, and should follow the means or not. He was showing this particular pattern, that whether we should also take care of the means or we should only take care of the ends. And other welfare schemes like trust, which brings the trust, which helps the trust building and the culture building of the DVC. So overall, we see that the leaders which work towards the, which cope up with the change and complexity of the change, are quite different from the status quo oriented manager. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we have 5 minutes for questions. Let me ask the first question to group four collectively. One of you can answer. So what is one or two words to describe Mr. Luther's leadership? Just one or two or three words. A punch phrase.
Hard on rules, soft on people.
Hard on rules, soft on people. All right.
Negative.
Pardon me?
Negative about Mr. Luther.
All right.
Sir, I don't know whether it is within the bounds of the case or not. But it was as if like the PSUs have been since their inception. It was
primarily focused on people. The vision was okay. It was for, it was not to that extent on growth. The situation on DVC.
Come here and talk.
The situation of DVC today. Where I think Krishna will agree with me, the charges of electrical charges of DVC, which DVC charges to industry and other kinds of consumers in its area of jurisdiction, is substantially higher than what other electric companies charge. The primarily the reasons behind this are a lot of activities which DVC does in the name of social welfare are totally free. As the name suggests, things should be free, but I think
okay, let me
gone beyond
you.
That.
Can you close this by a punch line? What is the criticism?
The criticism is
too much welfare? Is that what
too
you want
much,
to say?
Like typical Nehruvian focus on industry.
Too much welfare. Alright. Good. Thank you very much. I think you can sit down. Give them a hand. Now, questions from the house. We have 3 minutes. Yeah, tell me.
We said that they were hard on production, soft on
hard on rules, soft on talk.
Soft on people.
On people.
So I think he was selectively soft on people because when the ILCC leader confronted him, he immediately suspended him because he had crossed the Lakshman Rekha. So can you universally say that he was soft on people? It depended on the situation. As they behaved, so he responded.
So his style changed depending on the situation. But overall, you still agree that he was soft on people?
No, I wouldn't say he was soft. He empathized with people. He cared for their welfare. But wherever they crossed the Lakshman Rekha, he was very tough.
Let me ask you a question, which the class can answer, anyone. Was he task oriented or people oriented?
Mix.
Yes. Example of task orientation.
I think it was task oriented.
When I say task, I mean performance, organizational performance.
Task orientation in the absolute sense, without caring for the people. That is absolute task orientation.
Does the case suggest anywhere where he went after targets or set stretch targets? Let's stop that discussion on that question. Any other questions? Yes, Francis? No questions. Pass. Any other questions? All right. If no questions, we'll call upon group number one and excuse group number four. Huh? Group 1, please. Yes, it is possible. You can, if you want, you can write on this and it will automatically go on the board. Huh? All right, have you watched the clock? Viraj, keep an eye on the clock. What is your time?
I am started.
Your time starts now.
So this preparatory.
All right, preparatory. But he's eating into our time.
Yes, sir. I will try to make it as fast as possible.
you can call out, Viraj, what you are writing.
I'll come to this in a moment.
All right. So, you are starting now.
Yes.
It's 4 minutes to 4. Right?
Yes.
So, you have till 10 minutes you have.
6
past 4. All right. You start now.
Yes. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, friends. We are group 1. Let me just introduce my friends. I have Francis Borges, Devash Vakil, Sandeep Nellore, Srivath Rangarajan, who is unfortunately not here with us, and myself, Viraj Verma. Now, the question that we had to answer was, what does the DVC story tell you about leadership style and leadership growth?
Now, our group felt that the DVC story is totally explained in the first two pages. If you could just, if you have the case with you, if you just look at the data that has been provided, that Mr. Luthar joined in 80, till I was there till 83, and the data that we have was in 79-80, the company was an importer of energy of 63. Around 220 million units of power. Then improvement in revenue earnings from 1120 million to 2220 million. And other data that has been given in the same place reflect the whole story, the efficiency and the efficacy of the individual that Mr. Luthar was. Now, coming to the concept of leadership style, our group felt that it was very difficult to bring into explanation any particular theory that we had. Rather, the figure that I have put up on the screen is one of the best models that the whole theory, whole story fits into. Now, this theory is Hertzberg's situational leadership model, which explains the relationship between a leader's task behavior orientation and relationship behavior orientation. Now, when I say situational leadership model, it means that it doesn't mean that a leader is placed at one particular always along his behavior. What it means is that depending upon events, depending upon the situational requirements, the constraints that the leader faces, his behavior is around this normal curve. Now, the quadrants are authoritative if the task behavior is high and relationship behavior is low, delegative if it is both the relationship behaviors are high, responsive if both are low, and facilitative if the relationship behavior is high and task behavior is comparatively low. Now, to explain from the DVC story point of view, we have Mr. Luthar's behavior being related to all these four characteristics at different points of.
Don't be camera shy, Viraj.
I'm not sure.
Come into the camera. Hold this.
Yes.
So that you can be heard.
Now let us take these positions one by one. Authoritative, well, so we start with the example of the Mr. Luthar himself tells that the formula behind this success are on three areas:
discipline, accountability, and dialogue welfare. And when it came into implementation of disciplinary
system into the organization, the first thing was authoritative. That emphasizing on punctuality, emphasizing on attendance and the way it was implemented was purely on the behalf of his position. Again, he met people and tried to explain to them why these things are necessary for the organizational growth. Coming to delegative part of it, the best example is the grievance redressal forum that he set up with a mixed group of finance, personnel and other people in the organization, so that they could handle the grievances of the individuals at the plant level itself. At the different location itself, the redressal forum had own groups handling the grievances of the local people there.
delegation part of it here was quite evident
from this part of the story.
Now, responsive, although it brings into high, low in task and low in relationship, but it is definitely a basic nature of responding to the call of the situation. Like the power plant manager in Chandrapura, when he came up to Mr. Luthar looking for help, saying that he had some problem with the high school and all, the immediate action was that he had to go back to the plant, and he, Mr. Luthar, followed him the next day, and with strong action against the high, I mean, with strong action through his talk to the students, he immediately responded to the requirement of the power plant manager. But that doesn't mean that he didn't attend the high school requirements. He realized that all grievances, like he says here, to take his verbatim, he says that grievances are ultimately the results of some loopholes in the
implementation of management system. So it has to be taken
care of by
the management
alone. So
all the developments that were required by the high school were again taken care of by Mr. Luthar.
Facilitating, the last few pages are full of activities that he arranged for the organization. Setting up of libraries, schools, yoga classes, all facilitating a holistic growth of all individuals
related to the organization. In fact, who came into the
family of the organization.
We have 3 minutes, Viraj, and 3 speakers waiting down the line.
Sir, I am the only speaker of my group.
So what are they doing here?
I am the spokesperson.
They are giving you support out here?
I gave me support during my study.
Okay. Why don't they sit there?
To answer the questions.
To answer questions, all
right. Now, there are again several areas.
There are several areas theoretically explained as
characteristics of leaders that Mr. Luthar had exhibited at different points of time. Like being democratic, where he says that people are the basis of an organization, except that they should be following rules where they have to. Then motivating people to achieve high targets, without which the first few data would not have been practically possible. Then analyzing situations, like previously explained, each and every problem that he solved were results of in-depth analysis by an individual who was capable and quite self-motivated to do it. And he somehow imbibed trust in the organization itself. The different components of trust, like integrity, competence, consistency, loyalty, and openness, which is exhibited by the simple fact that he welcomed all kinds of grievance letters and frank responses from any individual, irrespective of the cadre in the organizational hierarchy that he belonged to write directly to him in case his grievances were not handled immediately. So our group feels that instead of putting Mr. Luthar into a specific school of leadership style, we would rather declare him as an ideal situational leader who performed to the best of his ability and to the best of the results that we find as and when the situation called for his performance. Thank you very much.
Good. Now, any questions? So he has summed up ideal situational leader. This is what Mr. Luthar is. That is the group's view. Anyone challenging that? That's the question. Is there any theory, theoretical framework?
The chart was a result of a theoretical.
Come here, Viraj, so that you can be seen answering on behalf of the group.
This situational leadership model is a result of extensive research by Hersey and Blanchard. I don't remember the year of research. In fact, it is still being worked upon.
It is still being developed.
I think, Viraj, the question is, can you make a statement, he is a situational leader. Can you give any instance from the case and relate it to the theoretical framework to show how he is a situational leader?
Yeah, I only explained that, sir.
Say, repeat it, he missed that. That means in situation A, he exhibited some type of characteristic of leadership. Situation B, which is different, okay, he exhibited yet another type.
Yes, sir.
That's the question, Vikas. Okay.
I use verbatim, we somewhere say that big small lies lead to big lies. That smallest infraction, if given big space, will lead up in larger infraction. So his step of acting to such happenings were quite automatically. Implementation of discipline, that is. And walk the path, which was simply behave what you speak. Otherwise, it's very difficult it's very difficult to motivate a group as such.
Then, in case of delegation, I said, we have grievance forum posted in different locations. In response, we spoke about responding to boss's individual problem and attending to the high school grievances by providing immediate funds and enhancing the school to help from class 10 to class 12. And facilitative is explain all
okay. So what we are really saying is, whereas in the first situation he was authoritative, right, on account of discipline, accountability, in another situation where he felt as a genuine grievance, he was welfare oriented. He could as well have said, no, I am not going to give you all this and spend all this money. But did he say so? No.
No.
He did not. He exhibited another characteristic whilst handling that grievance. That was more people oriented. Any other questions? Anyone from the back there? Yeah, they are engrossed in preparing for the thing, but you should listen also. That is part of the learning, listening to the other presentations. Any questions? No questions from this side? We are right at the end. No questions at all. So, you give them full marks. Any questions? All right. If there are no questions, thank you very much.
Thank you very
much. Next is group 2. Who is presenting for group 2? Okay. Have you noted the time? Look at the clock. It's 4:09. So you have till 4:19. Your time starts now. Please pay attention.
Ours is group number 2. Our group comprises Santosh, Arun, Reddy, Naived and me. While speaking about the leadership style of PC Luther at DVC, let me first of all mention that DVC was a public sector bureaucracy, replete with trade unionism, indiscipline, below par performance and lack of optimum production. So, in such a situation, the role of PC Luther was unique. What he did was, he played the role of the benevolent autocrat. On the one hand, he was production-centered, and on the other, he was people-centered. His production-centered attributes come out in the results that he produced. He increased production to 600 megawatts, made DVC an exporter of energy, increased its profits and net revenues, and on the people-centered part, he improved the welfare of the people at DVC. I'll give further examples as I proceed. Now, he changed his style of leadership depending upon the situation. So, while he was both production-centered and people-centered, maybe I'll rank him as 9-9 on the Blake Morton managerial grid. He was also situation-specific. So, if we interpret his leadership style in terms of Fiddler's contingency model, we find that the situation in DVC was not good. As I said, it was a bureaucracy with rampant trade unionism. So, the leader-member relations, the degree of task structure, the position power of the leader, all these were not really conducive to effective leadership. So there we needed a leader who was tough.
So in extremely good or extremely bad situations, Fiddler says we need a tough leader. In a middle of the road situation, an ordinary leader will do. So it was there that he fit the bill so well. Just some examples of P.C. Luther's leadership. He enforced norms, he walked the talk, he had innovative ways of doing things. He imposed discipline. People had to come before 9:30 in office. File had to be moved within 24 hours. He was uncompromising in his attitude when it came to matters of principle. He could stand up to bullying and pressure tactics as well as threats and physical abuse. His action on overtime, his action against INTUC leader, his action against the Bund, all these bear this out. Similarly, he could take risks. During the Bund, he staked his entire career on the success or failure of the Bund, and he came out trumps. He was a leader of people, a motivator, who imbibed the speed of performance in his people. But he could also instill fear where it was necessary. What he believed in, his style of leadership, was the imposition of just and judicious authority and the use of power. He also upheld human dignity. He brought forward a system of grievances, which was, not through the union. He increased the prestige of the management. The incidents at Chandrapura in the high school bears this out. He was also principle-centered, in the sense that means were always more important to him than ends. There was also a personal touch to his leadership. The letters to the chairman that anybody could write, the personal interactions that he had, the example of the Safaiyala in Chandrapura, whose hand he held and said, his dirty hand he held and spoke so beautifully to him. All these are examples of his personal touch in leadership. What he had was definite and specific goals. The letters regarding grievances, that if they were not issued within 90 days, he said, within 14 days sharp, I will issue these letters. So he was very specific, very definite in his goals. He could also inspire the credibility and the trust of his subordinates. He could motivate them and basically walk the talk. So it was his open communication, that was another aspect of his leadership. Open communication which bred mutual trust and self-respect. Another aspect of his leadership, which might be considered the people-centered aspect, was his dynamic welfare. What he speaks of in the case as a warm and visible leadership, that's what he says. So this warm and visible leadership showed his concern for the people. He spent time in the fields, he spent time on human beings, on their welfare, so that they could have a sense of shared pride in the organization. He looked after staff welfare, and what he did was he set up schools, libraries, yoga classes, and films for children of the staff. So all these welfare measures earned him the goodwill of the people. Another aspect was that he could forge a team spirit in the organization. So this team spirit and the involvement that he could bring upon DVC was something really unique. They had this esprit de corps in DVC after P.C. Luther took over charge of the leadership. Then he was also improvement oriented. The various improvement trusts that he set up for each subsystem of the thermal plants, they were a unique measure, something you can say akin to the quality circles we have in Japan. So for each of these quality circles, for each of these subsectors, what he did was he identified the flaws in those systems, how production was being carried on, what were the possible areas of improvement, and tried to improve upon them. So these innovative ways of bringing about improvement in production and efficiency was another very important aspect of P.C. Luther's leadership. And he was also daring. He was ready to bring about large changes, big changes, organizational changes, so that he could make the organization a functional one, a divisional one, from a basically functional bureaucratic hierarchical organization. So these were the changes that he brought about. So basically, when we end up, we'll have to say that the leadership role that P.C. Luther played was that he led from the front, he responded to challenges, he set personal examples through huge sacrifices, he looked after the welfare of the people, he dealt with change what he actually challenged the status quo in terms of Kurt Lewin's change model, three-step change model. We can say that he challenged the status quo, unfreezed the present status quo, then activated it, and then froze it again. So these three stages of unfreezing, activating, and freezing again was what he tried to and successfully brought about in DVC. That was his leadership role. So he also imposed the rule of law in DVC, inspired the trust and confidence of his subordinates, and made enormous sacrifices. In retrospect, we can say that he empathized with his subordinates, and also he could instill fear when necessary. So as I said at the very beginning, he was both production-centered and employee-centered, depending upon the situation. So that was the leadership style and the leadership role that P.C. Luther played in DVC. That's all. Thank you.
Good. Now, don't go away.
No, I'm standing.
Come and stand here. Any questions?
Three-step framework for managing change. Yes. You unfreeze,
activate,
and
freeze again.
Yes. The first two are okay, but when you're freezing a particular state again, don't you think so you're removing a change culture from an organization?
No.
It's not good to continue. Isn't it better to keep continuing changing with respect to environment rather than freezing a particular?
Let me respond. I mean, it was already a frozen situation which P.C. Luther encountered when he came in first. But if the freezing is for good, I mean, then it's fine. Of course, there are avenues for change anytime. When I mean change, I don't mean a permanent freezing of the change. Of course, maybe after a few years, further changes, further betterments, improvements might occur. That's it.
Any other questions? Devash? Any questions? Any observations? All right. Then we will give a big hand. Next, we have group number 3. Where is group number 3? Who is going to present? Come. Have you noted the clock? What time is it?
19.
You have till 29. Your time starts now.
Good evening, friends.
Good evening.
We have the case on the DVC story. Our question is the one that, how do you differentiate between a status quo manager and a leader, right? So, the group consists of myself, Darshpreet Singhman, Praveen Paritala, and Rajiv Bhushan, Ashtosh, and they're absent. But we, half of the presentation I'll manage, the other half he'll take over.
You lead and you'll manage also?
Yes, sir.
All right, good.
So, I'll draw the structural framework before he goes deep into a DVC case to bring out difference between a leader and a manager. First question, what is a manager? What is a status quo manager? Now, the basic definition says that a manager is a person who's able to derive work out of the other people. Now, this work is related to an organization context in which you're performing. Organization brings together people with whom you interact and you work towards a pre-specified goal. Now, in this context, a manager basically does the four roles, that is planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. Now, all these activities of a manager can be divided into four things. One is the traditional roles. Those are the controlling, planning, and all these things. The second is the HR development. You're training your people, you're regularly motivating them, you're causing their development. The third is communication, regularly communication within the organization. And the fourth is networking. Now, these are the four activities which a manager is mainly linked with. Now, a framework is given by Lutyens. Unfortunately, I can't bring it over to you. It says that how a manager divides his time between these four activities, like that describes his effectiveness. A simple manager, he is doing about 25% each in each of the four areas: traditional roles, communication, networking, and HR development. If you compare it with the successful manager or an effective manager, you'll find that the time that they are spending in communications and networking goes up. So we felt that this communication and network, they draw the pedestal for them, for these managers to go up and become leaders. This is the first line that differentiates a manager budding to be a leader and a manager who's going to remain there forever. Now let's move a little bit ahead and see that how do you differentiate between a leader and a manager. A manager is a person who manages complexity. Now this complexity comes in terms of setting targets for the employees, setting an hierarchy of the organization, and controlling, that is seeing if the targets are being met by the organization. In comparison, a leader is a person who manages change. The crux thing behind leader is that he has a vision. The second thing is that he aligns people to that vision. And the third thing is that he is continuously motivating them, pushing them to move ahead in life, causing their personal development as well as the development of the organization. So putting this into a framework, is one more thing that a manager does the things right, but a leader does the right things. Now going ahead, there's one more theory which we came across on the web. It says that, it's very interesting, it says that a person who have in the brain who are left side oriented, right, they are more methodological, they are more
logical.
Yes, they are more logical, they are more into mathematics, they make better managers.
Physics, chemistry.
Yes, they make better managers as compared to the people who are who have a stronger right side. They are more creative, they are more self-motivated, and they make better leaders. Now you can't say whether this is right or this is wrong, but he has drawn a number of examples saying that, you know, but it says that there can be people who are equally left side and right side strong. Like there are very few examples, like he said Leonardo da Vinci was one such case, who was a very good manager plus a leader. One more thing is that a good leader can become an effective manager, but it is difficult for an effective manager to become a good leader. Like the traits, incorporating the traits is difficult. But finally, drawing out 5 or 6 traits of a leader. First thing is desire to lead, sincerity and integrity, intelligence, work-related knowledge, and lastly, and the most importantly, communications and being a people's man. Now, one thing that a lot of people that was brought out in the case, that a leader has to be a self-monitor. He has to keep continuously, he has to keep changing himself with respect to the external environment. You saw it in Mr. DVC case, Mr. Lutyen, that first when the person comes when the person comes and reports to him, so that guy is aggrieved towards the school. But when he goes there and he sees the situation there, he takes a different perspective. Now that's the kind of self-monitor a leader has to be. Now my friend will take you deep into the case.
I can see that we are enjoying the case. That's good. You must enjoy what you do.
Man has clearly differentiated what a status quo, what are the traits of a status quo manager and that of a leader. Now I would take more into the case as in particular with the leader's case. So
how he is molded into the role of a leader. Now he has identified 3 different traits which are very important for bringing out radical changes in the organization. The 3 traits which he has believed are discipline, accountability, and dynamic welfare. Now in discipline, he has showed the trait of initiativeness, of tearing away posters, And this is tearing away posters is something related with risk, and no people have come forward to help him out. That means he has the calculated risk taking ability. Everybody can take risk, but there is the leader differentiates between those of other people, the managers, effective managers, whether he is able to calculate the risk which he is going to take, the calculated risk, whether it would reap in results or how much of what probability of it does end in good results. And this has, in this case, the calculated risk taking ability of tearing away the posters is supplemented with invigorating the environment by the beautification of walls. He is sure that once he tears away the posters, the unions will be against him. And in order to complement it, he has also added this beautification practice, which makes the people satisfied and which makes them not to again dirty the walls. And he was strict when situation demanded. And he has the courage to withstand pressures also. He is strict when the situation demanded. This has been clearly described when he has removed the personal manager from discharging his duties because he was not up to the expectations of his employees and up to himself. The next thing is accountability. Now, he believed in certain ethical values which does good for the welfare of the people, not only to himself, not only to satisfy his goals, but also it is centered more towards the societal values. He said that the means should be legitimate and we should not just believe in the ends. And he has shown a sense of camaraderie, which means equal treatment to all, whether he is a worker or whether he is a supervisor. He in fact initiated this camaraderie by shaking hands with a safai wala, and he has created a supportive climate where people are encouraged to come out with new ideas, where people are encouraged to do new things, and at the same time gather a sense of self-respect among the people. And it was clearly shown that when he is leaving out of the company, he was given a plate which has inscribed that this is to the man who gave us self-respect. That means he has won the hearts of his people overall. And this is the true trait of a successful leader. He is principle-centered and he is result-oriented. Not only is he is result-oriented in the sense that he is not just interested only in the in creating the profits for the firm, but also in creating a better standard of living for the people. And he has inspired trust and confidence. Now, when we come to the dynamic welfare, he has implemented many measures he has come out with various schemes for the widows, he has come out various schemes for the women, he has come out various schemes for the fisheries in order to develop the society in general. And apart from that, he also fostered the team spirit and a sense of involvement. He has asked the people to volunteer themselves in order to form the institution of improvement trust, where the people can come out with their creative skills and ideas in order to better manage their resources and for the betterment of themselves.
You have 30 seconds now.
Now, last but not the least, the organizational changes which he has taken over is he has the will to cope with the change, he has infused inspiration, he has, more importantly, he has empathy towards his people, but when situation demanded, he is a strict disciplinarian. Thank you.
How would you sum up, no, don't go away, how would you sum up in one phrase his leadership? One phrase. You can help him. The group can help him to sum up. One phrase.
Say the people's man.
People's man? Okay, not a boss's man. He was not looking for a promotion. People's man.
Get a lot of people, you will automatically get promotion.
People's man. Give them a big hand. Questions?
You mentioned only one attribute of a status oriented manager. Some other attributes.
Come here before you answer. No, come. Come here. Speak into. We want to record these pearls of wisdom. Come on.
Want to go through it again?
No.
Is there any other attribute of a status oriented?
Speak into the mic.
I'll take you again to the four roles.
No, don't go to the four. Sum up now. He wants something new. Don't give us a litany of what you have just said. Anything else? Can you help him?
So, the basic four activities are planning,
organizing, leading, and controlling.
Wait a minute. Status quo. What is the meaning of status quo orientation?
So, status quo is a person, an average
status
manager.
Status quo. What does it mean? It's a Latin
word. The present situation.
Present situation. Remains.
Yes, sir.
Present changeless. Remains.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Has he done anything to change?
Exactly. So, we're talking of
manager. He has done many things to change. He has challenged the status quo.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Right.
And that is in itself an exhibition of leadership. Right? Challenging the status quo. Instead of remaining powerless and letting the environment consume you. Okay? Any other question? Yes, Rohit.
Mr. Luther used to take calculated risk. If, for instance, that risk doesn't pay off and it backfires, then how would you get counteract it?
Good question.
I'll take it.
Speak into.
Whenever you take risk, there's obviously a downside of failing, but the important thing is that you should learn from that failure. That if suppose I go into a project and tomorrow it fails, the people who are working in that project, they have gained something. Maybe if I have gone into
Maybe if I've
gone into a new market today and I've done a small test marketing and it has failed, but that learning to an organization, I think that is very important. And you should always, like Hindustan Lever, it has so many projects. And you only hear of the successes.
You hear of the successes.
Yeah, but there are and much more number of failures which never come into the
close front. It now. There's an art of closing. Have I told you before? You haven't, I told the first years. Please learn how to close when you answer a question, even in interviews. Don't ramble. Answer the question, close it. That's called the art of closing. Okay?
Thank
now,
you.
One moment. I want to answer Rohit and before that we'll take two more questions. Wait a minute.
Close for the same question.
Alright.
The pattern, it was a calculated risk. So, the event of it not working out has been calculated.
His question is what happens if the risk fails? So, answer the question. I think I'll answer you, Rohit, by saying he'll have to take the rap. When you take a risk, you have to be prepared to take the rap. If it fails, or if it succeeds, bask in the sunshine of all the kudos that you get. Alright? Any more questions? One more I can take. Yes, Viraj.
He'll answer.
Alright? Give him the mic. He is armed with the mic now. Let him say. Don't answer in an interview before you hear the question.
Just citing an example of the bulb. The case, what if the bulb really took place? 6 power plants do not produce and what not? There is a big national loss. It's not an organizational loss. So, if a risk of that nature ends up with a loss to the nation, then who learns from the failure?
I just wanted to modify what he said.
He's asking you a question.
Yeah. We can't do
answer
anything. We
question.
Have to take the blame. Being a leader, you should be responsible for all the actions you take. So he'll be responsible, and he's ready for it. He was ready for it. In fact, the way he went on meeting people.
Okay, I think we'll have to close this session because the reel is running out. But before that, thank you very much. If you want to allow your junior, when you're a manager, to take a risk in taking a decision, then you have to risk your junior taking the risk of a decision. That's the big risk. Don't get too frightened to allow the junior not to take or to take a decision. Allow him to do that. Okay.
He thought was, when you are giving all persons the basic things what they are eligible of without any hassles, they already start to trust you. And when this element of trust is coming into the organization, then only you can start change. So he was there as a change agent, and he built up upon the trust, and he did that by his beliefs in basic three attributes. And the organizational structure when he came in was very functional and divisional, and he really thrashed it out, and then he decentralized the whole structure. And the organization when he left was decentralized from highly centralized. Then no divisional heads when he left. In the field location were very functional, functional oriented at the time he came. And he changed the structure to have an head for all functions at divisional level. So at that time he built the trust, and from that they accepted. Everybody has to accept the person who is telling him what to do, then only they'll believe in that person, and things will start moving in right direction. And in the dynamic welfare also, he taken care for the society, like renovating the residential quarters of everybody, where housewife decision was taken into consideration, and he was more risk. And everything what he did, first he practiced it, then preached it, because when you are saying something and doing something else, then really you cannot build the trust among your workforce or among your employees.